corner, jump shot. Patriots scores! Two in a row, Linton!
A long pass and the field goal is good.
That's no whistle! Mayport has won the state championship!
In a state without big-time professional sports, it is the Super Bowl, the crown jewel of North Dakota sporting events. The moment when 16, 17, and 18-year-old boys become heroes for a lifetime. The State B Boys Basketball Tournament is the fiber that binds small, rural towns together. Growing up in a Class B town, the players were real heroes you saw every day, neighbors you knew. They all seemed so much bigger, and we dreamed of one day playing in the state tournament. As the years have run by, the memories remain strong as townspeople still talk about the games, the plays, and the players. They are events that define a community, and for the athletes can be the moment they are forever linked with the rest of their lives. In the next hour, you will see the players, coaches, and teams that helped create the rich 67-year history of the State B. You may find your town, team, friend, brother, father, or son, or perhaps simply rediscover that sense of community. The celebration of the small town that is North Dakota Class B basketball.
Support for this program is provided in part by Dakota Growers Pasta Company, the Prairie Region's grower-owned pasta cooperative, and by the members of Prairie Public.
I mean, they wouldn't do it for a debate tournament, and they wouldn't do it for a drama, but if you went to the state basketball tournament, these small communities just shut down.
I think the Super Bowl of North Dakota sporting events.
George Morgan takes it down, tries a long one, and it's good. 24.
The first State B tourney was played way back in 1933. Orrin Zilgut, now 84 years old, scored the game-winning shot for Fairmont in their 32-30 overtime win over Candu in that first ever title game.
And I jumped in the air as far as I could and threw my arms up in the air, of course, and tipped it, and fortunately it went right through. I figured our coach, Julian Toughness, was going to pass out. He was so excited.
What is it about Class B basketball that makes fans act this way? Why does getting to the state tournament mean so much? Part of it may lie in the fact that in small towns, everyone knows everyone, and an investment is made in kids. Sometimes as early as sixth or seventh grade, a class can be tabbed by the town for athletic greatness.
When we were in elementary school, we had some people comment about how good we played together and how good a team that we had and the potential.
Trying to give room to work. And
then there are the obvious differences between Class B and Class A ball. The state Class A tournament is what it is, a showcase for the biggest schools and usually the best teams and players. But Class B is different in two distinct and special ways. The success or failure of the team engulfs the community, and it is much harder to make state. Gene Manson played in the State B for Langdon in the 60s and now coaches Minot High.
A Class A, you can create some of that atmosphere and environment, but you're never going to get the same because sometimes it's almost expected.
I guess I always felt after the regional, everything else was dessert and cream.
It was such a community event that, that and church.
And Class B basketball, it's so great for the state of North Dakota. I mean, everybody comes out and supports it. You know, it's kind of like, it's almost like the sport.
The Class B kids were up and down the court. It was a spectator's game, and that's why you got 10,000 people to the Class B tournament.
Fire wagon basketball. Up and down the court, there wasn't a heck of a lot of defense.
And in a way, the awful North Dakota winters have helped harness the game to its frenzied level. With the state tournament signaling the end of winter and the beginning of spring, sometimes.
Long winters, there's not much to do in North Dakota on Friday nights, Tuesday nights, Saturday nights.
It's the only game in town. You know, there's not a lot of other things in the wintertime, and it's still winter in March.
What it all adds up to are players, coaches, cheerleaders, and dedicated fans who, through victory and defeat, have made the tournament what it is today.
We
Here's Wick. Inside, Clint Saucer with the drop.
Sometimes one player can completely take over and dominate a state tournament. A player who makes everyone else around him better and leads them to a state title. What follows is our all-time State B starting five.
Rice, Jim Glizzo, Henry Melky, Leroy Rice. Game. Shooting from way out and missing it is Henry Melky.
Henry Melky didn't miss many shots during his years at Minot Model High School, but this rare footage of the 1953 state tournament held in Minot at least gives us a glimpse into his talent, which old-timers still talk about.
Remember now, I've seen a lot of Class B ball players, and some of them are going to be offended, but he's the best I've watched.
Once basketball season started, then I was a gym rat. I mean, I was in the gym all the time.
Shot by Minot Model, who's been doing a fine job of rebounding.
Milky was unusually tall for a guard in those days, 6 feet two, and his combination of shooting, ball handling, passing, and playmaking helped take the game to another level, faster, higher scoring. From 1947 to 53, Minot Model won five state championships. Milky started for the last two title teams. Model is no longer a high school, but their teams, and Milky in particular, are still remembered and talked about. At age 65, Henry is still vibrant, in terrific shape, and the old swagger is still there.
And I can look in a mirror today, and I whatever I do, I give 100%.
He had confidence. He talks confidence. You visit with Henry now, he's got so much confidence, it just flows out of him. It's fun to be around him.
He could have played Division I basketball and had an offer from the University of Minnesota, but halfway to Minneapolis, he changed his mind, turned the car around, and went home. Instead, he broke records at Minot State, married his high school sweetheart, went on to a distinguished 30-year career as a referee, and never regretted the decision.
I'm still a North Dakota boy. I could care if I ever left the state of North Dakota.
But I've just never, ever been around an athlete like Butch Lintz.
Jim McPherson still remembers the first time he ever saw David Butch Lintz walking down the hallway at Mott High School in 1960, a 6'5", 225-pound sophomore. The new coach only hoped this man-child could play basketball. He was right. Butch was the kind of player who could have scored 30 points every game, but he didn't. The statistics don't tell the whole story.
Because you can't win alone. You need all five. You need seven players to win, because we're gonna make you die. Full court press from the beginning of the game to the end. I could care less about what I scored.
You didn't get any second shots, not with Butch around. There were no second shots. If you got a big person in the post, Butch is going to shut him down. I never played against a college basketball player who was as good as Butch was when he was a senior in high school.
Mott racked up 56 straight wins en route to back-to-back state titles in 61 and 62. Lintz was an unstoppable offensive and defensive force both years, and he played with four new starters as a senior in 62, proof of his ability to make others around him better. A stellar all-around athlete, he went on to earn nine letters at UND, played with Phil Jackson on one of the Sioux's greatest basketball teams, and played in the NFL with the Philadelphia Eagles. He is married with three daughters and now lives in Dayton, Nevada. But the long-ago memories of Mott, North Dakota still burn bright.
There are 6,000 people in that area that thought they won. And that's, you know, that feeling. And no matter where you go, they say, thanks for winning it for us. Thanks for winning for us.
There's the pass to Jerry Pyle. From the corner, he shoots and scores. Oh, this Pyle kid, just a machine.
When you're 6'7", can play inside, shoot from the outside, handle the ball, and make steals, you're tough to defend. That combination of height and skill may be commonplace nowadays, but imagine high school boys trying to guard that in 1968. Such was the task of stopping Castleton Central Cass's standout center, Jerry Pyle.
I tell you, there must not be many shots this kid can't make.
Everybody knows in North Dakota, that Jerry's probably one of the best players to ever walk in the gym.
Tremendous athlete, handled the ball, shot from the outside, and was 6'7", which was a monster in those days.
Well, I think it helped a lot when I was 6'5 in seventh grade, so that started talk.
Including that Jerry Pyle, it's unbelievable how he handles himself.
Pyle's performance in the 68 tournament remains one of the most dominant in B history, 102 points and 59 rebounds in three games. But the always humble big man credits teammates Don Severson, Jerry Ford, Larry Blixt, and brother Bob Pyle.
You can stop one guy. You can stop two guys. Almost any coach with any brains can stop a two-player team. It just wasn't possible to do that with us.
Mike, this is Pyle. Could you do one more?
Today, Jerry is married with two children and works at Great Plains Software in Fargo. After high school, he had a standout career playing basketball at the University of Minnesota, but it's just not the same as winning the B.
I've never experienced anything like it, anything close to that in my life in terms of a team.
He's a good ball player and a sharp shooter.
1972 was the first year Mayville and Portland consolidated to form one school, but the basketball team wasn't expected to make state. They were only 14-6 heading into tournaments, but they had a secret weapon ready to unleash, 5'10" shooting ace John Rigg.
That's all I did. I worked on a farm and shot baskets.
Strong jump shot coming up from John Rigg.
The Patriots' upset favored Buffalo in the Region 2 final 67-66. At state, they were underdogs again, but in the opener against Ashley, poor free throw shooting by the Aces, along with Riggs' 29 points, gave Mayport a 73-68 win. In the semis, they faced highly ranked and favored Oaks. Oaks played man-to-man defense, which proved futile in stopping Rigg, who made 12 of 14 shots from the field, en route to 34 points and an 87-57 blowout.
John Rigg, 18 points, good.
Well, we all tried to cover him.
We all tried to cover him, probably two at a time. John was a wonderful player. I remember very much his quickness. He was very fast. He would change direction. He could dribble a basketball and come up on you and back up and still keep momentum going. And you almost had to try and guess which way he was going to go. And if you guessed wrong, he had an open 12, 15-foot jump shot.
I don't know if we could play that well again.
The next night, Riggs scored 32 as the Patriots held off Berthold 66-62 for the Class B crown. These days, John is married, has two children, and works at Artco in Fargo. But to this day, his 95 tournament points and 72% shooting from the field remain one of the greatest and most talked about performances in State B history.
And I was pretty fortunate to have that good a shooting percentage. It was just a nice tournament.
Jimmy was maybe the best in the state, but when I saw Rigg, then I realized that there was another player as good as Trett in North Dakota.
Well, I shot 30 of 50 for that tournament, and he was 34 of 47, so I kind of overshadowed that.
Gets it down to Rigg, driving on the left side of the lane. Drives for two. John Rigg, they have four down.
Forcing him to shoot from the outside. I figure Eddie Beyer is thinking that.
Look at that!
Yep, there it
Look
is.
Look at that steal!
If there was ever a state tournament with a man playing against boys, it was 1988. When Edinburgh's Scott Goldseth looked at times like he was playing at a different speed.
Scott Goldseth, I thought, might have the most talent of any Class B player that I'd seen.
I knew in most games and in most instances that I would always be able to get my shot off.
Heading into state, Goldseth and Edinburgh were still something of an unknown to the rest of the state. But in the opening game, perennial power Hillsboro found out in a hurry who Scott was as he poured in 25 points in a 55-42 win. But Goldseth's big game came against Hankinson in the semis. 43 points, 13 rebounds, and 7 blocked shots in a 79-71 win.
They didn't really have, anyone taller to match up with me, and then they played man-to-man, which we hadn't really seen it all year.
Edinburgh finished off their dream season, beating Divide County in the final 64-55. Goldseth finished the tournament with 91 points, 39 rebounds, and 12 assists. He went on to Louisiana State, but ultimately transferred to UND, where he had a brilliant career and played on North Central Conference championship teams. Now 13 years after his high school career ended, the complete floor game he displayed has still not been equaled in Class B basketball.
It still elicits some goosebumps, and it makes that special bond since you'd played with those guys for so many years.
There are other state tournament record holders who deserve mention. The single game scoring mark was set by Gary Bakken of Cooperstown, who scored 49 points in the 1966 consolation final.
Straight through him. Three-pointer.
The three-game scoring mark is now held by Wiley Bearstail of Mandaree, who racked up 109 points in the 1999 tourney.
Ryan scores again.
The career points leader in state tournament play is Dick Ryan of New England St. Mary's. Starting as an eighth grader, Ryan played in five state tournaments, culminating in the Saints' 1970 state title his senior year. In 15 tournament games, Ryan scored 232 points, an average of 14.5 a game.
Ryan really turning in a ball game. 20 seconds to play in the corner. In Minot. Minot Models Beaver Kits for 1953 in the state class.
Minot Model High School was established as a teaching school. It no longer exists, but the school's basketball accomplishments have helped keep its memory alive. During a seven-year stretch from 1947 to 53, Model won a whopping 5 state titles.
Nobody paid any attention to Minot High. It was all Minot Model.
The only other school to win state during that stretch was Southeastern Conference power Lisbon, winning it all in 49 and 51. Model's domination and upbeat fast break style of play set the tone for the era and helped change the high school game. In 47, the Beaver Kits beat New Salem in the final 68-50, and they trounced Rugby 51-28 the following year.
Even in the late 40s when Model won, they got up and down the court. They pressed, they got up and down the court.
In 1950, Gene Groninger completed his standout career with 22 points in a tight championship win over perennial power Kenmare 42-40.
By Minot Model, has been doing a fine job of rebounding here in the semifinals of the championship bracket.
Superstars Henry Mielke and Jimmy Walker paced the 52 and 53 title teams to 47 consecutive wins. Considering turnover and graduation, it's doubtful there will ever be another run in North Dakota high school ball quite like Models.
I do think we must have been pretty good when we're after just about 50 years, we're still remembered.
The next great dynasty would come from the southwest part of the state. Mott has been to the state tournament 8 times, but it's the 61 and 62 teams that brought home the hardware. Coach Jim McPherson, who would go on to great success coaching Williston, began his career at Mott. His techniques have influenced other great coaches, and he taught his players a defensive intensity which was simply too much for other teams to handle.
That's what our practices were, hard-nosed, man-to-man practices, and of course it really paid off.
See, the thing is, we'd switch defenses and the teams on the court had no idea what we were doing. There was respect for the coach, just pure respect. Jim's a good person.
But I remember on Saturday morning they had a coach's corner out there, a radio show, and I went down there and McPherson was there, and I remember sitting and watching him and I thought, boy, that guy's got his stuff together.
McPherson also had players. 6'5" center Butch Lintz anchored the middle for both title teams. In the 61 state final, the Cardinals walloped Hazleton 77-54. The next year, Lintz and 4 new starters never missed a beat.
Because he made everybody around him so much better. Hard to believe that a postman could do that, but he did it.
In the title game, the Cardinals held off New England St. Mary's 58-42. They would ultimately extend their win streak to 56 games, the second longest in state history. The record is 79 by Olson of the old Class C division from 1956 to 59.
Look out, Bauer has it, he lays it up and right through. Kenmare is dominating.
Nestled by Dalle Lacs Lake north of Minot, Kenmare is one of the prettiest small towns in North Dakota. It's also known for basketball, which you are reminded of when you drive into town. Kenmare has been to 15 state tournaments, the most in B history, and between 1963 and 67, they would write their greatest history.
Did develop some tradition with players that young kids could look up to, which is very important.
Never blessed with height or great athletes at Kenmare, Jerry Meyer's style was ball control, good defense, and looking for the perfect shot.
You know, if you didn't play at both ends of the floor, you didn't play.
When you coached against Kenmare, you had to do some coaching to win a ball game because they were really well coached.
I had a player tell me a couple of years ago that he was a helicopter pilot in Vietnam, and he said the discipline that he learned in sports probably saved his life over there. And I don't think there can be any better compliment than that.
The first title came in 63 when Meyer's Iron Five beat Newtown 54-48. All 5 Kenmare starters played every minute of every tournament game. In 64, Kenmare may have had an even better team, but they were harassed into more mistakes than usual by Fort Yates' tenacious and quick defense. 65 may have been Meyer's best coaching job. Hit with graduation losses and possessing little height, Kenmare reclaimed the state title, beating Madoc-Benson County 50-31. Then Meyer made the tough decision to leave Kenmare for Jamestown High.
Came here and they won the state and I won 3 games.
The Honkers never missed a beat. New coach Paul Kranz kept the same philosophy and they pounded Milner 69-41 to win a third title in 4 years.
The Hawkeyes won another state title.
So the Milner game, and I think that's kind of Paul Kranz's philosophy came out then, because every once a couple times that year, he did open the game up.
With Bauer back in 67, the Honkers reached their fifth straight title game and lost to Ellendale. Still, their achievement is one of those records that will likely never be equaled or even approached again. In the late 60s, the balance of power shifted from west to east, specifically Region 1 in the southeast corner of North Dakota. In 1967, the undefeated Ellendale Cardinals were led by a group of talented seniors and a tenacious 6'2" sophomore named Charlie Sizer.
I just kind of learned you got to do it or die, and I just played as hard as I could.
The showdown came in the Region 1 final at Wahpeton between the two unbeatens, Ellendale and top-ranked Castleton Central Cass. For all intents and purposes, it was the state title game.
And I didn't know Charlie Sizer from Adam, but I got sick of him in a hurry. He would come at you, and he just was like a kangaroo and would just go right over the top of you.
Sizer and Ellendale connected on 32 free throws in stopping Cass 62-58. Once at state, Ellendale cruised to three double-digit victories. After Central Cass's dominating 1968 season, 69 belonged to Ellendale and the balanced Fargo-Oak Grove Grovers, with five starters averaging double figures.
We played a lot of ball and really got to know one another, and I think that was one of our strengths. We knew each other so well.
Both teams stormed through the regular season undefeated, and the two Titans met in the regionals. With seconds to go in the game, the Grovers led 47-46, and Ellendale prepared for the final shot, a favorite tip play to Sizer.
It worked, you know. I got the ball in my hands. That's what it should have. I should have been the one, I guess. It didn't go in.
And the ball did kind of, you know, it did the typical bounce up in the air thing, you know. And of course, you have Bedlam after that.
The Grovers struggled somewhat at state, but prevailed over Hebron in the final 48-44.
It's also very humbling, I think. The bounce of a basketball between victory and a loss, like in the game against Ellendale. I mean, what happens if that ball goes in? We now lose that ball game. We're not having this conversation here.
In 1970, New England St. Mary's brought the title back west. But in 71, Region 1 was back with the undefeated Winemere Warriors. In a tense final, All-State center Ron Becker scored 25, and Winemere topped New England 70-69 in overtime.
You have a feeling like you've never had, and I've played a lot of basketball since being in high school, and still that's my most outstanding memory in all of basketball. I've played over 30-some years.
Region 1 had completed an unlikely run. Four state titles in 5 years, and among the Big Four, no losses to Class B competition.
Burke gonna take the shot. Beautiful stop, but it rebound by Meyer.
Region 2 would dominate the next 10 years, winning six titles between 1972 and 81. Mayville-Portland in 72, Larimore in 78, and four titles for the newest dynasty, Hillsboro. While the town has produced great players over the years, most agree the lion's share of the credit begins and ends with one man.
Introducing the fast break game, which is one of the competitions that we run during camp.
He is Ed Beyer, the winningest coach in North Dakota high school basketball history, 678 wins in 36 seasons at Hillsboro. Frequently booed in opponents' gyms, described as brilliant, fiery, genius, volatile, loyal, he is all of these things, and he is Hillsboro basketball.
Some of the kids come back and talk to me at times, and one of the things they said was, you know, we expected to win.
Steal. Here we go again.
The hallmarks of Beyer teams include tenacious defense.
Beautiful feed to Nelson.
Mastery of the fundamentals.
They don't take the shot unless Eddie wants them to.
And an almost obsessive passing and ball control search for the perfect shot. Some have criticized this brand of ball as deliberate and boring, but the banners prove he knew what he was doing, and he's respected equally by former players and fellow coaches.
You know, you played basketball in the mornings throughout the year. I think he was ahead of the time in that respect. We needed somebody like that for us to win.
He tried to get the most out of you, but sometimes it was, you know, tough love.
He was one of the great role models for the rest of us, and coaching against him was a phenomenal high.
Eddie Beyer had his team so well prepared defensively
they knew what to do to stop your best offensive threats.
If you were going to play Ed Beyer, you know, you had to lace him up a little tighter that night, you know. And I think that's what he brought to Class B basketball more than anything. You know, he made people have better programs.
The first of Hillsboro's titles came in 1973 when the Burroughs pummeled previously unbeaten Partial.
Olson, Burke, inside, he got it.
The next year, the Burroughs returned big man Keith Meyer and Tom Olson as starters. Though not as explosive as the 73 team, they played great defense and the new starters flourished in the Beyer system.
We really didn't have any one star. We actually, you know, everybody was just play good defense, score when you can.
Quick, White Owl to Marcette, comes into the lane, sidearms one up, that's good!
Wow!
In 1980 and 81, Hillsboro would play terrific back-to-back state tournament games with another perennial power, Newtown. In the 80 semis, the game was tied at 40 with time running out.
Beach, Stewart, 3 seconds, jump shot, no good, we're going overtime! 22, Christopher didn't get it, the rebounds, good, we're tied with 40. So, oh, look at that steal. Right out, picked and clean.
We knew that a good defensive effort every night will help you win games.
Two Val Finley free throws later, Newtown prevailed 46-44. They beat Berthold the next night to claim the school's only state title.
Oh, is that a nice move? Wow.
The next year, the Burroughs and Eagles both came in undefeated, ranked 1 and 2 respectively. And because of regional seedings, were forced to play in the opening round. Hillsboro maintained a 6-8 point lead throughout, but late in the fourth quarter, big man Kyle Meyer fouled out, and Newtown caught up and forced overtime again, 40-40.
White Owl. Now he's going to. We're tied again at 42.
Forward Brad Stewart would also add 2 free throws to bail the Burroughs out, 45-44.
I had confidence that everybody could step up and make a shot. And lucky enough, it was me.
Here's Meyer. He's the key. That's why.
The rest of the tournament was a formality as the Burroughs trounced West Hope and Edmore to become Ed Beyer's one and only undefeated state champion.
It was more relief than celebration. You know, we'd, like I said, had that as a goal for so long.
This Beck. In 1984 and 85, Linton and Newburgh hooked up in back-to-back title games. Undefeated Linton won the first one easily, but it's the rematch that may well be the best title game in state history.
52-50 Linton, and beautiful!
In a tense seesaw affair, Newburgh led 66-63 with seconds to play in regulation when Linton sophomore Bobby Petrick delivered a miracle.
There it is!
It was unbelievable how many shots he made at the buzzer to end quarters, to end halves, to end games. He just had a knack for it.
Tied at 70 in the overtime, lightning struck again.
The goal to Rorick. Corner, jump shot. Petrick scores! 2 in a row, Linton! 2 in a row, Linton!
It's kind of funny that people remember it a lot. They say they remember it a lot better than I do, but you know, they have me making half-court shots, and that's a lot of odd things, but I still get that once in a while.
Petrick's heroics robbed longtime Newburgh coach Bob Hunsker of a first state title. But in the aftermath, the always classy Hunsker showed all he could muster when he addressed his dejected kids in the locker room.
We walked in the locker room and the kids were laying on the floor, most of them crying. Their world had just fell apart. So we asked them to sit in a circle and we all held hands. And together we thanked the Lord for the privilege of losing, because in losing, they would gain many more lifelong skills than if we had won.
But sometimes in life, things do work out perfectly. And in 1986, Newburgh returned and won the state title over Belfield, 94-77.
Fletchock outside, a three-pointer, he got it!
In 1991 and 92, Munich and Watford City battled in back-to-back years. In 91, Watford prevailed in the final 65-64. The two squared off in the opening round in 92, and Munich got its revenge 61-43, led by Mr. Basketball Marty McDonald. The Magicians went on to defeat Leeds in the state title game, giving Jack DeMaine his first state title.
The greatest thrill was for the kids, not for myself personally, because they had worked so hard.
Munich and Watford are two of several other undefeated state champs. They are Mayville in 1946, Castleton 1955, Hedinger 57, Mayville-Portland 87, Minot-Ryan 94, and Fargo-Oak Grove 2000.
Wow, these Allard brothers are really tough. Stolen again by Bob Allard. Here he comes. You got it.
Holy cow.
One of the premier television events of the century, I think, in North Dakota.
I don't know where you are or what you're doing tonight, but I hope wherever you are, you're having as much fun as we are here.
This is the story of how two teams got to the 1977 state final. Two very different teams with two very different coaches from two very different parts of the state. If there is one game that best defines the essence of the state B, it is this one. The mighty Hillsboro Burrows against tiny Epping, enrollment 23 in grades 9 through 12. What resulted was a fever pitch, David versus Goliath atmosphere at the Bismarck Civic Center that hadn't been seen before and hasn't been seen since. And no one who was there that night will ever forget it. The Epping boys are back home, together again. At the local tavern, the wives have even prepared a cake.
Yeah, look at the color. Isn't that just perfect?
A reminder of that once-in-a-lifetime season and the 3 days in Bismarck when they were kings of North Dakota.
Hi, Bob. How you doing?
The starting five, Bob and Don Allard, Clyde and Mike Vinger, and Jay Bingaman, are all in their early 40s now, and only Jay still lives in Epping. But nearly a quarter century later, they are still treated like royalty here, this tiny town which still doesn't have paved streets. They are revered in a way that only happens in a small town. Maybe it's because Epping was never known for basketball, once losing 96 straight games in the late 60s. But it's the kind of treatment they've received all over the state for the last 24 years.
All you got to do is mention Epping and somebody's going to remember it, it seems like.
You get that today, too. I mean,
oh, yeah. Yeah, still.
Somebody happens to mention basketball, or you tell them your name, and they say, oh, you guys were on that 77 basketball team.
It's happened for the last 20 years.
It's something us five will never forget, and it keeps us together. I mean, we're all good friends, all five of us.
Theirs is one of those unusual, unpredictable sports stories that always make for the best drama. And in all great dramas, there is a hero and a villain. The Epping Eagles would play the hero in this drama, and through no fault of their own, the Hillsboro Burrows would ultimately fill the role of villain.
1 second, the last shot of the game, it's over! And the Hillsboro Burrows, for the second straight year, are the
Meanwhile, on the other side of the state in Hillsboro, they are used to winning. Four state championships, 14 state tournament appearances, only two losing seasons in 40 years. For 36 of those years, the man with his hand on the throttle of the Hillsboro machine was the legendary Ed Beyer. By the time the players on the 77 team became juniors and seniors, they knew exactly what to expect from the detail-obsessed coach.
We gotta get somebody coming across high. You guys, everybody's sitting too low. Step up and shoot that ball there. Come on.
Now move the ball, try and get it inside, but let's take a good shot.
Eddie Beyer stands up and yells, oh, look at there. Think he's saying out there.
We got two timeouts left, gang. Now we gotta have boys.
Come on now. You guys have gotta quit making stupid mistakes.
Look at Eddie.
I don't think I'd want him mad at me.
I've always felt I was a Jekyll and Hyde because, like I said, if you know me, I love to joke and I love to have fun, and a lot of people really disliked me because I was constantly on my kids. And I love my players, and there's nothing I wouldn't do for them, but at the same time, they're going to perform or they're going to know it.
Well, he was very demanding, but I think we wanted somebody who was willing to push us because we had high expectations as a team ourselves.
If a guy didn't put out 150% for this guy, I mean, you were on the bench.
And with all the accolades and praise, Ed Beyer will tell you the game he still hears the most about is by far the Epping game.
we got ourselves ready prior to it, played a lot of basketball during the summer, and knew that if we were going to do it, that would be, have to be the year.
I mean, everybody knew what everybody else was going to do. Our senior year when we started, he said, you guys know how to play basketball, we're just going to get you into shape.
Expectations were high in Epping heading into the 76-77 season. Fifth-year coach Larry Overbow's strategy was to utilize the team's athletic ability by playing aggressive defense and fast breaking whenever possible.
The one thing about that team, I think, is we passed the ball so well.
Coach Overbow, you know, his ability as a coach was, you know, he was, as far as I'm concerned, he was the best.
Led by their talented and physical front line of Clyde Vinger, Bob, and Don Allard, all standing around 6'1", the Eagles steamrolled through the regular season, averaging nearly 70 points a game. They only lost once to Beulah in the third game of the season, and a big highlight was defeating Watford City for the first time in school history.
We had as good a team as anybody in the state. It was just a matter of us playing well, and we did play well.
In districts, Epping beat Watford again, 56-52, to advance to the Region 7 tournament. After beating Watford for the third time in the region final, it was off to state and a brand new experience.
We wanted to win that first game so we could stay on TV.
Yeah. It was just wild. I mean, the teachers, we'd go to class and all we talked about was going to Bismarck.
We didn't have buses, though. We never took a bus to a game.
It was all cars.
Yeah. Somebody had to drive.
And see, we all grew up in the country. We never really left Epping. The biggest town was Williston that we'd probably go to.
At state, the Eagles survived an opening round overtime game with Turtle Lake Mercer winning 58-55 and then won a turnover-riddled semifinal with Wing 61-56. The wins hadn't been pretty, but their rough-and-tumble play only added to the team's growing legend. The city of Bismarck was in an uproar over this Cinderella story, but a powerful and tournament-savvy opponent still awaited them.
Rebound, Hillsborough. Oh, what a play by Tommy Olson.
By 1977, Hillsborough had already been to five state tournaments and won back-to-back titles in 73 and 74. The players on the 77 team had grown up watching this and expected the same out of themselves. The tradition and mystique were firmly established.
I think we had high expectations for ourselves, but we also knew it was going to be difficult because of all the other good teams in the area as well.
I think between tradition and the coaching, that was, we had a big advantage before we even got on the court with a lot of teams.
He's going to pop one from 18, and he got it. Boykin, he's shooting.
All-state forward Dave Nelson and 6'4" postman senior Joe Han and junior Randy Waters did much of the scoring, with guards Paul Eisenbys and Scott Kelly quarterbacking the team and scoring only when needed.
They were probably as group of five as good a group of kids as I've ever had.
I think the team was very unselfish, and you know, whoever we needed to step up and play the big game could do it. I remember Paul during warm-ups, every game he'd ask me, how you feeling tonight? You hot tonight? You know.
Everything gelled in 77, and the Burrows were ranked number one most of the year, losing only to Cass Valley North and Larimore. But there was nervousness because this was the heyday of Region 2, and 1977 was the year everyone still talks about. Heading into districts, five Region 2 teams were ranked in the state's top 10, Hillsborough, Larimore, Mayville-Portland, Cooperstown, and Devil's Lake St. Mary's, and all were capable of going to state.
We could have taken our region to the state tournament, and it could have been a very entertaining tournament.
The Burrows were stunned in the district finals by Mayville-Portland, but they rebounded and won three tight games at regions over Larimore, Devil's Lake St. Mary's, and Cooperstown to survive and advance.
Heading towards the state, you know, we felt confident, and the thing we looked forward to was playing some teams that didn't know us.
In Bismarck, the Burrows were relaxed and confident and opened things by throttling Munich 68-48.
Hankenbauer, he got that one.
In the semifinals, hot shooting Minnewaukan came out blazing and made their first 10 shots. But Dave Nelson answered with 25 points, and the Burrows' patience and experience paid off with a 71-63 win. They advanced to their third state final in 5 years, but the reception they were about to receive was unlike anything these teenagers had ever experienced.
For Epping's Eagles, and here they come, the darlings of this tournament, the Cinderella team in North Dakota. Number 43, he's 6 feet, senior, and there's the whole Epping Eagle. Number 40, Joe Henn.
Greensboro, getting a lot of boos.
As a 17-year-old high school kid, you don't expect quite that reception when you're being introduced at a basketball game to that boisterous a crowd, and you know, I don't think you can ever be prepared for that.
I remember going onto the floor, coming out of the locker room to get onto the floor, and they had to clear the way to help us get on there with those security guards. And
10% was for Hillsboro, and 90% of the crowd was for Epping, and they were the darlings of the tournament. It was epic. It was a hell of a day.
You could actually feel the electricity in the crowd.
You know, I think we had better talent, but boy, they were scary. And I knew that the atmosphere was going to, I didn't realize it was going to be quite that bad until I got there, but I knew that we were going to be the Lone Rangers on that one.
We hope you're going to enjoy it.
But if the Burros were bothered by the boos and the frenzied pro-Epping crowd, they didn't show it.
Nice pump. Hillsboro leads 2-0. Slapped around. Hillsboro's got it. Eisenbeiss, the cripple. 4-0, Hillsboro.
The disciplined and focused Burros jumped out to a 16-5 lead after the first quarter. Epping couldn't make anything, and Hillsboro couldn't miss.
Here's Allard, 15-footer. Rebound, Bingaman, no good. Here's Nelson, 18-footer. Good! Inside to Waters, tough shot, he got it.
And they can't make the cross-court pass against a good hustling basketball team.
They can't make the free throws either. Here comes Hillsboro, 2-on-1. Beautiful play. Oh, yeah.
On my part, it was jitters, I think. It was just caught up in the moment with all the people.
But things just weren't going our way, and I'm sure it probably was nerves.
We jumped out to the quick start, which was a key. As I think back about it now, if we'd have struggled at the start, I'm not sure we'd have been ahead going into the fourth quarter.
Always prepared, Beyer had taken Epping's favorite play away from them, the long outlet pass. And their height was getting Clyde Vinger into early foul trouble.
And gonna drill one, right through.
The Burros built their biggest lead of the game, 20-6, early in the second quarter. But suddenly, Epping settled down and began chipping away at the big lead.
Over to the other side, Mike Vinger. Let's her go and score. All right, here comes Epping. Clyde Vinger. Here's Allard. His shot. Good.
And once we got behind, we knew they were going to start spreading it out, and it wasn't a favorite of ours or the crowd. And then we just had to hustle twice as much as we had to all year.
Overbowl wouldn't let us quit. Yeah. I mean, you went. There was no stopping. If you stopped, you're on the bench.
The Clyde Vinger inside, underneath the Bob Allard. 2 for Epping. Beautiful play.
This Bob Allard layup cut the lead to 6 at 24-18. But Scott Kelly's driving hoop gave Hillsboro a 26-18 halftime lead. Still, it was suddenly a ball game again. Epping's second quarter momentum continued right away in the third.
Allard from the corner, good! And here comes Epping!
The game seesawed back and forth, but Hillsboro held Epping off and actually rebuilt and extended their lead.
Waters takes the shot, he got it! Look at that move, too bad, missed it, follow is good! By Randy Waters. Kelly gonna pop one. He hit it. They almost double team now. Foul against Clyde Vinger. He's all done.
And to make matters worse, Clyde Vinger fouled out.
Boys come in and shake his hand.
He was crying afterwards. it's even emotional for me now.
He averaged 20-some points a game, and he gets 2 that game.
One. Yeah. 1 point that game.
Plus the fact of, you know, me and him being the big guys to rebound, and losing him brought in a smaller guard.
But suddenly, with the score 34-22, Epping would begin one of several scrappy and emotional second half runs.
Here's Bob Allard inside, his best move, yeah. Good play. Don Allard in the lane, shot, good. Bob Allard, short, rebound, stolen, Bob Allard, yeah. Stolen again by Bob Allard. Here he comes. You got it.
Holy cow. After him.
8 seconds to go. Bob Allard, shot. Good! Look at Eddie Byers calling the shots there. He's getting nervous.
You couldn't communicate on the floor, you know. Nobody could hear anything, you know, so I couldn't communicate with the kids.
Well, I know when we were chasing them all over the floor, that was giving them some problems.
Yeah. And they didn't worry about, you know, the time on the clock and the score of the game. They just played.
It was 38-33 with 8 minutes left.
1 quarter to go. Hillsborough leads by 5. They once led by 12. Here's Joe Head inside, fakes, and scores.
All through the game, Hillsborough's players showed a poise beyond their teen years, blocking out the crowd and seemingly always having the answer to an Epping run. The final quarter would test that poise to the limit, with frenzied back-and-forth shifts in momentum that would leave players and fans alike emotionally drained.
Back out to Don Allard. Allard for the basket. Off the glass! Cleared off by Don Allard. Nice move! Oh, you bet! There, they don't pass that one up. Beautiful play. Randy Waters scores for the Burros. There goes Hen for the basket. Oh, yeah!
Hillsborough had a 48-37 lead, and moments later, Mike Vinger fouled out. In Hillsborough's heyday, when they got ahead of a team, that team was usually through. But this night would prove different, and Bob Allard was about to take his game to another level.
Allard pumps one, looks good, right through.
I think they were just thinking that we'd quit. We would give up, and we never did.
I remember Bob Allard as being having the capabilities to carry a team.
They stole it from him. Allard again. No, he didn't get it. Rebound that time, he did get it.
Don't anybody go away. The miracle workers are at their best right now.
No good again. We got a foul. It's against Randy Waters. All for Waters. They need every point. He didn't get that one either. Rebound, Don Allard. His shot is good. Trouble out near the center line. Jump ball. Oh, what a play by Bobby Allard.
Well, the talk of the press box was that this is not happening. You know, it can't be happening.
Trailing 48-44, Epping was primed to cut the lead to 2 for the first time since the start of the game.
This place is gone crazy.
A basket might blow the roof off the Civic Center, and the most controversial play of the game would happen next.
Bob looked at me and he kind of nodded his head and I nodded my head. I knew what he was going to do.
The ball, Don Allard. His shot is up. It's good. Oh, no, it isn't. No good.
First of all, he didn't dribble and then come up with it. He grabbed the ball in the air and came down with it. I mean, he hadn't even had control of the ball yet, for one thing.
Has called it.
From where I seen the play, there was absolutely no question in my mind. I've never doubted a call. If I can't make a call like that, then I shouldn't be out there on the floor.
We're not going to win or lose a game on a call here and there.
I think that took a little air out of them. It took a little air out of the crowd as well.
Indeed, more so than the no basket call, the fatigue caused by all of Epping's chasing around and playing catch up finally showed at the free throw line. The Eagles made only 10 of 25 for the game, which proved fatal.
We didn't really shoot free throws well the whole year.
Let's see if he can make this one. He did! The three-point game now.
Jay Bingaman made his second free throw to cut it to 48-45, the closest Epping would ever get, because the Burros were about to put it away.
He has it. Hillsborough, underneath. Burke got it! Burke scores for Hillsborough, and they lead by 7 with 59 seconds to go. Ball stolen.
Bob Allard and his mates still wouldn't die. A last valiant run got it to 54-50, but Hillsborough didn't miss their free throws and survived 56-52.
He's late. He's trying to get...
We brought her up as close as we could, and we ran out of time.
I've never been so happy to let down so many people that night.
To hang on in that situation under those circumstances, you know, it was quite an accomplishment for our basketball team. And
I had some kids that had tears in their eyes and they were kind of down, and I said, you know, we had as good a year as we could have possibly had, and be proud of yourselves.
No, there was no disappointment that I can recall. Mm-hmm. And I remember Overblow having, you know, saying what a great year we had.
Yeah.
I don't remember there being any disappointment.
In the aftermath, Epping was treated like the victor, the toast of the state. Returning home, they were given a hero's welcome and streets were renamed after the players. Hillsboro brought back the expected third state title with decidedly less fanfare.
I heard later that they had streets named after players and so forth, and we didn't have that in Hillsboro.
That's what's tough, to have them go out there and everybody boos them. If they knew them, they'd have trouble booing them. If they knew them like I did.
The Hillsboro Borough.
Since 1977, the two high schools have taken very different paths. Hillsboro's unprecedented basketball success continued with another state title in 1981 and eight more trips to the state tournament. Coach Beyer finally called it quits after the 97 season. The living legend is enjoying retirement in Hillsboro. For Epping, it was the first and last hurrah. They never got close to going back to state, and within a decade, the school would close because of low enrollment. But there was a fierce fight to keep it open thanks to one remarkable weekend.
Well, I remember the it was a long ways out there.
Nearly 10 years after the 77 title game, the Epping players invited the Hillsboro team out for a rematch at the Williston Gym to raise money to save the school. The game was ragged and uneventful. Hillsboro won 51-46, and Bob Allard pulled down 29 rebounds. But the real highlight was the bonding that happened after the game.
We got to know him after that, after we had our fundraising game, yeah. And just had a really good time. It was a lot of fun.
Haven't seen him since, but sure like to again.
That rematch was a lot of fun, and I'd like to see some of those guys again.
The weekend in Epping was memorable, but the school closed soon after, merging with Ray. And because of school consolidation in North Dakota and the death of the small high school, it is doubtful there can ever be another Epping-like basketball story.
Get ready.
In the ensuing years, the players have moved on to successful lives and more important obligations. And an odd and wonderful thing has happened. The Epping players have become modern-day folk heroes, symbols of a time when a school with 23 students could dream of glory and the embodiment of the term victorious in defeat.
You know, they think we won it.
Yeah, they still do. A lot of them say that. Yeah, you guys are the ones that won state back then.
Yeah, the year you guys won state, you know, they'll talk about it. What year was that? Well, I hate to tell them we didn't win.
I can close my eyes and hear those Epping folks, whether it was in the bar, the restaurant, the lobby. Here we go, Epping, here we go.
That game is a big part of our tradition as well, but for them, that is their tradition.
That 77 championship game for them was monumental. For us, it was a championship game that Hillsboro was supposed to win. But for Epping, they became kings.
I'd just like to say thanks to not only the Epping fans, but all the fans around the state that supported us. And something we'll always remember.
Championship this year, I bet.
Oh yeah, no one ever here, so we're fun.
All right, enjoy it.
Yep.
Yeah!
Good job, Dennis Wyman. Feet inside, and oh, now does that count as a jam?
Based on sheer athletic talent, the Mayport CG squads of 96 and 97 can stake a legitimate claim as the best team in state history.
Gives to Swift, left side from 21.
With a frightening combination of speed, power, shooting, and defensive skills, all of the starters, including guards, stood 6'5" or taller. Most Class B opponents were outmatched before the opening tap.
They had size. They had depth. They had shooters. They had post people. They had post people who could shoot. They had guards who could post up.
And LeClaire comes away.
Andrew LeClaire and Chuck Claybo provided the inside muscle.
Up and down the court a little bit. Alley-oop, oh. Jacobson. And
Tom Jacobson, Matt Swift, and Travis Kraft provided a deft combination of inside play and outside shooting.
Picked up by Darren Claybo, layup is good.
And throw in Darren Claybo and Jeremy Masakovic, senior starters in 96.
You don't find a lot of high school players with the attitudes that we had. We wanted to win every game we played.
All the time we spent together, you just kind of grow like brothers.
You know, and I know me and Matt, we actually had brothers, you know, play with us in 95, 96.
17, but it's been a 12-4 run by the Patriots.
Head coach Del Kessler had the enviable task of coaching this talent, and he started noticing it early on.
We were playing, I think it was an eighth grade game out in this gym, and Andrew LeClaire got the ball at half court and come down the floor, and all of a sudden he goes up and dunks the basketball.
And that's probably part of that experience factor. And LeClaire.
The first shot at glory came in 1995 when the second-ranked Patriots faced top-ranked Carrington in a memorable state semifinal. The talented but youthful Patriots weren't able to stop future NFLer Jim Kleinsaucer, who cleaned up with 25 points.
Ahead, Kleinsaucer scored. Was expected. Kleinsaucer three inside. And here's Wick. Inside, Kleinsaucer with the drop step, the easy two, and he'll go to the free throw line. You can't stop him if he gets it there.
Listen, who's on that weak side on Kleinsaucer?
And Andrew came to the bench once, and he said, I think it's going to take me 2 days to get around him. He said, I can't get around him to deny the ball, and if I try to, he just arm bars me, lifts me right off the ground.
Yeah, he's a big man. He's a good athlete. He always has been. And it was fun to play against him. And he did. He really took it to us that game. We really had no answer for him.
Late in the game, Jeremy Masakovic tied it at 52. Mayport got the ball back, and Kessler decided to play for one shot until...
Label looks inside, and it's a steal by Hayback with 5 seconds to play. Hayback, and it's blocked!
Two Carrington free throws later, a last-second Hail Mary shot fell off, and Carrington went on to win state the next evening.
Yeah, that was a big game for us. You know, they were basically the Goliaths. You know, they had, you know, big guys across the board, and we had a great team that we just played as a team. You know, I don't think we had a guy that averaged over 15, 16 points.
I was surprised at how tough they took that loss. They were devastated, and I didn't think I would see that out of them because I didn't think it was that important because they were so young.
I mean, it was agony after the game. You know, we couldn't really say anything. We didn't know what to do.
With a stable full of studs coming back in 96, the players rededicated themselves to winning state. The Patriots stormed through the regular season, blowing out teams with regularity. But during tournaments, they went into a shooting funk and ran up against arch-rival Hillsboro in the district final.
Baseline. Pass comes into Burrow, puts up the shot, it's good.
Mayport played sloppy, got behind the much smaller Burrows, and lost 39-34.
I think that Mayville Portland for about 4 or 5 years had the best talent that there's ever been in Class B. I don't necessarily think they're the best team because I'm not sure they ever played reached their potential. We should never beat them.
You know, they really kind of set us back a little bit, and they put us, you know, straightened us out a little bit, and they told us, you know, that we gotta come out and play hard every game. And
a Hillsboro rematch never materialized in regionals because the Burrows lost in the semis. The Patriots did refocus one region, and after beating Enderlin and Langdon, found themselves in the state title game against highly regarded Beulah.
I will bet you that the turnaround by Jacobson with the left.
Mayport built a first half lead, but in the second half, Beulah got on a roll and took a 41-37 lead into the fourth quarter.
Basketball, but he shoots 46% from three, and he's got to take some. But look at that. Way behind the line. Jaden Olson goes to the hoop. Oh, man.
Trailing 44-41, Matt Swift tied the game from long range.
Three-pointer by Swifty. Just as I was saying, they were back in it like that.
Then Kessler made a crucial move, putting his trust in sharpshooting freshman Travis Kraft.
I kept kind of looking down the bench, and he kept kind of looking back at me. And
I have no idea still to this day why Coach Kessler put me in. There was no one within 10 feet of me, and I was not even thinking about it. I just shot it and went in. And
this is what we talk. Look at this, the freshman.
Matt Swift hit another jumper to increase the lead to 49-44. Their superior talent had seemingly put the game away, but the Patriots began missing crucial free throws, and Beulah came back and cut it to 49-48, setting up a wild finish.
They can't foul. Jaden drives, won't go. Big rebound by McClaire, and he's fouled right away. Andy, 1-1. Won't go. Rebound. Timeout. Right away. Here comes Jaden Olson. 2-1. Shot. It's blocked. No whistle. Mayport has won the state championship.
First thing I did was run to Mr. Kessler and jump up in his arms and, you know, and
you don't plan for stuff like that. It's just the joy that comes out of it, you know.
I've been waiting for this all my life. I saw my brother do it in 87, and I've wanted this all my high school career, and we finally got it.
With LeClaire, Jacobson, Swift, Chuck Clabo, and Kraft returning in 97, a repeat title was expected. But Coach Kessler decided to find out just how good his team was. To get ready for the season, the Patriots would play four large Minnesota schools, losing to Minnetonka 64-51, and then going 2-1 in a holiday tournament in the Twin Cities, losing to Eagan, but then beating Anoka and Champlin Park.
It took us a game or two to get adjusted, but it really helped us for the rest of the season.
Jones making a move, and a lob pass down low to Clabo.
The tough early schedule proved to be a good move. The Patriots would win their last 23 games of the season, romping to three double-digit victories at state and beating Glenburn 69-53 in the finals.
Jacobson answers it. Olson was 0-for-4 yesterday in threes. Clabo finishes on the break. 4-3, Matt Swift. Indeed, one of the best teams in Class B history.
It's unbelievable to do it once and to do it two times in a row. It's great.
I had a great experience with those guys because they would do anything for me and I'd do anything for them. And, you know, that's kind of the best part about it. And, you know, now in college you realize how good you had it.
After the season, Coach Kessler would hang it up after 26 years of coaching at three different schools. He is now the principal at Mayport CG.
It could never be better than that again. And, you know, why not go out with those memories?
So where do the 96 and 97 teams rank all time?
I think I would definitely have to say ours was the greatest team. These kids could do things with basketballs and moves that we never dreamed of back in the 60s.
I'd like to think that we're up there somewhere close to the top, though.
And really, it's not over yet. All five starters off the 97 team would go on to some form of college athletic careers, so the rest of this amazing athletic story is still to be written. No tournament was ever left in ruins like the 1976 State B, when the Lemoore Lobos decimated the competition. It remains the most dominant state tournament performance in B history.
It is Lemoore, the king of Class B basketball.
They just sort of dominated our conference, our district. Once they got to the state, I mean, they took care of three teams, two of them undefeated, and just sort of wiped them out. Great team.
We earned this. We worked for this. There was a lot of sweat and a lot of hard work put into doing what we accomplished.
Indeed, the road to the 76 title was not an easy one. Nestled in southeast North Dakota, Lemoore had not been known for basketball and had never been to a state tournament. But the magic of small-town basketball is that it takes only one special class.
I can remember back even seventh grade us talking about our goal was to win state.
But the Lobos would first suffer two crushing defeats. Lemoore was supposed to go to state in 75. Highly ranked and with only one loss, they were upset by Fullerton in the Region 1 final 43-34, a team they had beaten twice before during the season. Then in the fall of 75, the football team reached the state finals, but lost to Watford City 21-17.
And especially to a team we think we should have beat.
Along with Theelgis, Lemoore would play 6'6 center Bruce Shockman, who had grown between his junior and senior year. 6'4 forward Darrell Haugen, forward David Olson, guard Mark Shockman, and sixth man extraordinaire Steve Kennedy. A devastating combination of size, quickness, and scoring ability. But it was Theelgis, the leading scorer and a natural-born leader, who the others looked to.
I don't know of a player that was more intense than Leon.
He would get us together, and he would talk about what we needed to do, and we just kind of followed him.
I wasn't ever going to go into a game, coming out of a game, and say, you know, I didn't give it my all that game. You know, I was going to leave it out there. You know, that was just me.
The regular season was basically one blowout after another. The highlight was a 52-39 win over highly ranked Mott in the Lemoore gym. Sixth-year coach Terry Olson employed a tenacious full-court press most of the time and knew he would make a mistake by overcoaching his athletic team.
Well, my favorite coach was John Wooden.
I really respected the, you know, what he does. He didn't holler, he didn't rant and rave.
Every day at practice, we come to work hard. We didn't have easy practices. There were times at the end when we'd even want to do more running and stuff like that. Not many teams wanted to do that.
We did? What practice were you at?
Undefeated heading into tournament play and heavily favored to reach state, the players were confident but always remembered 1975.
And we used that every time we played. Every time we'd go to Valley City for the district tournament, Fullerton's here. We always wanted to remind ourselves what happened in that Fullerton game.
Perhaps because of 75, the Lobos didn't blitz through Region 1. They opened with a 9-point win over a tall Fingal team and beat Fairmont by 10 in the finals. Once at state, though, the players finally relaxed and Coach Olson would unleash the horses. In the opener at state, Lemoore slaughtered an overmatched Rolla club 88-64.
What I remember about it was our so-called scouting report on Lemoore, and it indicated that Shockman would take a head fake, usually get himself into foul trouble early. Theelgeese would get rattled. The team was slow. Don't worry about him. They came out. They pressed us from the moment the ball was tipped. Shockman had, I think, 3 or 4 block shots in the first 4 or 5 minutes of the game, and Theelgeese was cool as a cucumber. It was shocking.
Puts it out to Leon Theelgeese. Theelcats get 26-14. What a fresh hurry it is for the Lemoore Lobos.
The highly anticipated semifinal showdown with Lakota was a blowout from the start and a 78-54 romp.
We shocked them, and they spent a good portion regrouping.
I remember one of the other coaches saying, God, I was trying to call a timeout, and by then I was 12 points behind.
20 points for Theelgeese, 64-43, and this Lemoore is really sizzling.
It was the same script against unbeaten Newtown in the finals. A quick start and an inevitable blowout, 86-61.
There's Theelgeese again, and the party's over for Newtown. Well, Newtown gave it a good go, but Jim Glaser has just waved the surrender flag.
Tell everybody who you are and how you feel right now.
I'm Mark Shockman, and I feel great.
A lot of talent on that team. We played them in the state championship, and they kicked our butts pretty good.
When you are a champion, it does something to that group. There's a bonding there that you can't really explain it until you're part of it. It's quite a valuable thing.
That and tough losses. Tough losses make you bond together.
We had a bunch of guys that hated to lose, let's face it.
Much has been made over the years about the Lobos' blowout wins of 24, 24, and 25 points. It has never been approached before or since. So does that make them the best team ever? If everyone could magically be 17 and 18 again, how would they fare against Mayport CG's dominating 96 and 97 teams?
So were we the best? Of course, we think so. But
we beat two undefeated teams in the state tournament, so that's one thing we can brag about.
We're biased. Yeah,
the Mayport kids, I know, are very, very good. I think we could have handled them. I think it would have been a heck of a game.
I would rank us number one. Have to.
These kids know what they're doing. They've played together a long time, you can tell that. Here's Theelgeese. Look at that move.
We'll take time out. Clarence Christensen, an explosive Castleton ball club. Pivots around, shoots, missed it, pile! Put there to score.
Perhaps the best of all Class B teams during the 1960s was Castleton Central Cass's squads in 1967 and the championship season of 68. And over a 2-year period, the Squirrels played and beat such brutal Minnesota competition as White Bear Lake, Moorhead, and Bemidji, and they eclipsed the 100-point mark 12 times in 2 seasons.
This is a long time ago, fellas, and we had guys that could handle the ball between the legs and behind the back passes, and in 32 years ago, it was kind of, we're breaking new ground.
We're a good show.
At the side, Severson. Severson scores.
Expectations can be a curse or a blessing, and the Castleton townspeople expected plenty after Cass went to state in 65, Jerry Pyle's freshman season. The big man was already 6'5" in seventh grade, and by his junior year in 67, Cass was ranked number one in the state.
When you win a lot of ball games, and there's always pressure. I think you put a lot of it on yourself because you know people know they expect you to win. So,
the Squirrels had lost only once during the 67 season, a last-minute thriller to eventual North Dakota Class A runner-up Fargo Shanley. they faced the unbeaten Ellendale Cardinals in the Region 1 final, which had all the hype of a state final. Ellendale pulled off a 62-58 win over top-ranked Cass and went on to win state, a title Cass thought they could have and should have won.
They kind of made us play their game. They slowed it down, and we had to play catch-up ball, and we ended up fouling them quite a bit.
You spend the whole summer sitting on a tractor thinking, I'm never going through that again, and we're not going to let it happen.
Pyle, Jerry Ford, and Don Severson returned for their senior years in 68. They were joined in the starting lineup by juniors Larry Blixt and Jerry's 6'4" brother Bob, who in often heated practice sessions would provide Jerry with some of his most intense competition.
When we were on the farm, we were the only two who were out there, so we had to play against each other. We never got to play with each other.
Cass was blessed with a number of great athletes who had been part of three straight undefeated seasons in football, and Coach Elroy Berg knew that if they were to finally win state, he would have to utilize everyone rather than rely solely on his 6'7" superstar, Jerry Pyle.
There's no doubt about it, he could have broken every scoring record in the state if he'd have done that. But I also knew there was a lot of talent going along with him, and I felt that I wanted to develop all of them. I just sit back and watch a show. That's all I had to do.
During the regular season, Cass once again lost to Shanley, but the highlight was an 80-63 dismantling of Moorhead in the new Moorhead Gymnasium. Moorhead would go on to finish second behind Edina in the Minnesota State Tournament.
It might have been the best game overall that Central Cass ever played.
I think it did, you know, raise some eyebrows. Wow, these country kids can play. And we stuck Moorhead good.
And then I tease people all the time that I did at Concordia, saying, well, we've never played Moorhead again because it just didn't give us a very good game.
The Region 1 final rematch with Ellendale turned out to be a revenge blowout for the Squirrels, 78-55. And then it was finally on to state.
Stolen by Jerry Pyle, drive way up is good.
After an opening round win over five-time state title game finalist Kenmare, the Squirrels then raced past New England St. Mary's 76-68 in an entertaining semifinal, led much of the way by the Saints. In the finals, the Squirrels met Cinderella team Wolford and their outstanding scorer, Vance Bowersox.
Jerry Pyle up, shoots, scores. So Jerry Pyle and Bowersox having quite a battle.
Up and under, scores again. It's Pyle and Bowersox now. Bowersox and Pyle with a conversation here with 2 seconds to go. Just like a couple of brothers. So isn't it great that Jerry Pyle and Bowersox played through an absolute standoff here tonight. 38 points each.
But Cass had more balance and won the title, finally pulling away from the smaller, scrappy Wolves 95-77.
But we stayed with them, you know, through about halfway of the third quarter, and then it's almost like they went into another gear.
It was good basketball, and it was artistic, and it was fun.
Jerry Pyle, all 6'7" of him, brings it across, drives the middle. Look at that layup!
Jerry Pyle would dominate the tournament with 102 points and 59 rebounds, would go on to a fine basketball career at the University of Minnesota, and the 68 Cass team would step into history.
We were just the best that there could be, and that community will talk about it today. If I walk into the community and sit down at one of the local taverns.
Back to Ford in the corner, he's going to shoot. Good idea, he hit it.
Jerry Ford went on to play basketball at Valley City State, and Don Severson quarterbacked NDSU in football. As to where their 68 team ranks all time.
And I think schedule over history, over time, might say that we'd be pretty strong in that vote for one of the all-time best teams.
So how would they fare against the powerful Mayport CG teams?
I'm just glad that we don't have to play a Mayport team now to prove it.
But when asked the same question, leave it to the always confident Jerry Pyle to throw down the gauntlet.
They had a lot of forwards playing guard, and they would have had trouble with us. They wouldn't have wanted to play us.
It's an absolute happening, that State B. Always has been. An event.
I was so lucky to be part of that thing. It was, you know, and they paid me for it.
Every time I go home, I'm to ask about it, you know, what do you remember most about it and things like that.
This is the advantage of being the last championship team from your hometown is, they'll remember you.
And when you get into that state tournament, you know that you aren't going to have that many chances, and so it becomes so precious and so special at the time.
That's one of the highlights, you know, of my high school career and everything. And I obviously, went in state like that. And we had such a great group of guys, and it was fun to play in front of a big crowd, in front of the whole state. It was fun.
Everybody gets that recognition, and everybody gets to brag about it to each other, you know, and talk about it for years to come.
That era, that's a few years ago, and the town people still remember it. It was quite a time.
It's quite a feeling, yeah.
I'll tell you this, they could take this whole wall away from me, and I wouldn't feel bad. But if they took the friends away from me that I've made through refereeing and playing, I'd feel real bad, because that's what it's all about.
Support for this program is provided in part by Dakota Growers Pasta Company, the Prairie Region's grower-owned pasta cooperative, and by the members of Prairie Public.
For information on Prairie Public Services, including how to order additional copies of One Shining Moment, call 1-800-359-6900 or visit our website at www.prairiepublic.org. Now stay tuned for bonus footage from One Shining Moment, the history of the North Dakota State Bee.
The Garrison Troopers for 1953, coached by Al Keck, the players Ernie Saylor, Lee Robinson, Bud Keck, Robert Fisher, Pearl Keyes, Len Hummel, Dennis Thompson, Harold DeHaven, Russell Willits, Gordon Giles, and Dennis Huber. The Troopers for 1953. Now West Fargo in the state Class B meet for 1953. West Fargo coached by George Galloway. Players, Dick Sampson, Kurt Kinnett, Leon Burford, Roger Lindgren, Gary Stensatter, Wayan Kinpatrick, Glenn Kinnett, Kent Hansen, Donald Lindgren, Earlis Tollefson. West Fargo, 453. As they play West Fargo in the semifinals of the Class B 1953 tourney here at Minot. Garrison is leading West Fargo 60-47. Garrison is in the white uniforms, and the West Fargo team in the green, or as they appear on your screen, the black sweat. At the free throw line, Kurt Kinnett of West Fargo. Kurt Kinnett. He was fouled by number 26, Ernie Saylor. Kurt trying one, and it's not good. Not good. Bounces out and very neatly handled by Harold DeHaven. DeHaven passes way down, and the ball is picked up very neatly by West Fargo. And it's out of bounds. Out of bounds, West Fargo. Standing outside to pick up that ball, Roger Lindgren. Passes to Kinnett, back to Lindgren. Kinnett takes it across the line. Takes his time. Passes the ball to Glenn Kinnett, misses the ball, picked up by Garrison, and Garrison taking it down. 27 seconds left to play. Garrison leading 60-49. 22 seconds left to play. Number four, that's Ernie Tollefson. On Ernie Tollefson, shooting Len Hummel. Len Hummel shooting the free shot for the Garrison Troopers. Up and in, that's 61-49. 21 seconds left to play. Semifinals, the championship bracket of the Class B tourney at Minot. Long pass down to Glenn Kinnett, who dribbles across the line. Glenn tries one, no good. Picked up by Lee Robinson. And Lee did his best. Lee did his best, but committed a foul. Garrison taking the ball down. Number 28 is Lee Robinson. Dribbles across. Passes to Robert Fisher. Tries one from the side. No good. And another foul committed. Number two is Kent Hansen. Garrison leading 63-51. 2 seconds left to play. 1 second left to play. There is the horn. The game is over. Garrison wins over West Fargo 63-51 in the semifinals of the Class B state championship tourney being played at Minot on March 20th, 1953. Now look at those victorious teams. Very happy, and you can't blame them a bit. Cheerleaders, cheering section, team, coach, everybody having a good time. Opening minutes of the fourth quarter of the game between Kildare and Rugby in the semifinals of the consolation bracket of the state Class B tournament here in Minot. The score is Rugby 49, Kildare 17. Rugby 49, Kildare 17. Rugby is wearing the white jerseys and the Kildare team, the dark jerseys. Committing that foul was Milford Oss, number 51 of the rugby team. Ball goes up and almost in and out again, one of those heartbreakers. They happen in every game. In and out again. It's Wayne Terrace trying to shoot that one in, and from the side, Norbert Schwann tries one, and no good, and it will be jump ball. Jump ball. For the rugby team, jumping is Jack Munson, number 54. Up in the air, rugby recovers, and taking it down across the line is Douglas Spillam. Passes in, Leo Eisenzimmer. Leo tries one, passes again to Jack Munson, in and out, and recovered by Kildare. Number 39 taking the ball down is Larry Sagisman. Larry looking for a receiver. Passes to number 41, that's Wayne Loisel. Wayne tries one, no good, and recovered by rugby in the very quick pass, and it's missed. Missed completely by Jim Fettig. Ball goes out of bounds. 51-17, rugby leading Kildare in the semifinals of the consolation bracket of this Class B tournament here at Minot, North Dakota on March 20th. And committing that foul was Gary Torgerson. This is the 1953 Beach team, the Buccaneers, entrant in the state Class B 1953 tourney being held at Minot. The team, Jerry Hay, Bill Barris, Bob Tobias, Merrill Sonic, Kenny Thompson, Bob Raisler, Gerald Newdeck, Bob Miner, Larry Barris, Bill Yuckert, Merwin Odenbaugh, and Con Short. And the coach is Jerry Moriarty, the 1953 Buccaneers from Beach, North Dakota. The 1953 Broncos from Lisbon, North Dakota, down here at the B tournament in Minot. The coach, Kenny Uland. And the players, James Bach, Leroy Foss, Laurel Gamachi, Robert Hansen, John Hopley, George Morgan, Alan Mims, Ed Rotenberger, Dallas Kopp, Dennis Kelch, and Dennis Klaus. The Broncos for 1953 from Lisbon, North Dakota. Left to play, Lisbon leading Beach 21-20, and now Beach breaks that, and it's 22-21, Beach leading. Lisbon taking the ball across, number 21 with the ball, and 14 takes it across very fast, trying in Dallas Kopp, and loses it completely. All right, now the Beach boys working it down. The Bucks have a very nice record this year. Number 3 is Jerry Hay. Number 11, and he's back to the camera, is Larry Barris. And number 18 called for fouling. That's Ed Rotenberger of Lisbon. Ed Rotenberger of Lisbon is called for fouling. Now, Beach is leading 22-21. 4 minutes and 49 seconds left to play in the second quarter. This is the semifinal bracket of the consolation rounds here in the state Class B meet 1953. And he sinks it to tie the score, 22-22. George Morgan takes it down, tries a long one, and it's good. 24-22, Beach leading by 2 points. Number 18 takes it across, that's Ed Rotenberger. 14 with the ball is Dallas Kopp. And there'll be a foul called on number 12 of the Buccaneers. It's Bill Yuckert. Standing at the free throw line for Lisbon is Dallas Kopp. Dallas Kopp at the free throw line for Lisbon. Beach is leading 24-22. There's the first one, no good.